But, for example, sorry, I'm at that age where I can't figure out something. God has a wisdom for allowing things to happen. We may never understand His wisdom, but we simply have to trust His will. Or when things happen that you cannot understand, understand there is a reason for every occurrence. God knows best. Or sometimes God's blessings are not in what He gives, but in what He takes away. He knows best. Trust Him. Now, these little snippets are what I call Facebook fluff. It's things you see on a flag, on a t-shirt, things that are meant for encouragement, inspiration. Not necessarily, they're not scripture, but it's a spin, common word spin on scripture, for example. But depending on my mood that particular day, sometimes they make me want to punch something, and sometimes they just make me want to cry. You're supposed to know, in understanding, that Scripture, however, never fails. It is always true. And so Isaiah 55:8-9, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Now, in other words, God knows what's best for you. The title of my song is Better Than I.
entitled Remembering with Rocks. Some of us think you've got rocks in your head, right? We're remembering with rocks. How do we handle the big problems in our lives? How do we make it from trouble to safety? And how can God help us in times of crisis or distress? Maybe the real question is, how do we count our blessings when it doesn't feel like it's time we're in a blessing? Our scripture today, reading today, is from Joshua chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, 6 and 7, and then verse 9. The children of Israel, again, this is in the beginning of the book of Joshua. They haven't started the conquest of the promised land yet. They're just crossing the Jordan. And a lot of times we forget about the parting of the waters. We remember the Red Sea crossing when God parted the waters. But we forget about the parting of the waters of the Jordan as the children of Israel are crossing from the east side into the promised land. But there is that. And then there are a couple other times that the waters parted as well. Once for Elijah, and then immediately thereafter for Elisha as he came back across the Jordan. So there were a lot of those water crossings when God parted the waters, took the problems away. And today we're going to look at one of the ways that we can reflect on those experiences. Starting with verse 1, when the whole nation had finished crossing the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, choose 12 men from among the people, one from each tribe, and tell them to take up 12 stones from right where the priest stood, and carry them over with you, and put them down at the place where you stay tonight. And then verses 6 and 7. When your children ask you, what do these stones mean? Tell them that the flow of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. In verse 9. Joshua set up the 12 stones that had been in the middle of the Jordan at the spot where the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant had stood, and they are there to this day. Joshua and the children of Israel lived in an era before we had pictures. They couldn't get everybody together. Yesterday we came down 16th Avenue and across the street from the building here was a family gathering. And they were all together for a picture. And they couldn't take pictures back then. And so they had to come up with a way to remember and reflect and to tell the story. See some of the pictures we've taken over the years? They couldn't take a picture album down off the shelf and flip through it and relive the stories and the memories. We've only been able to do that for about two or three generations. And the generation that went before this one had everything on paper, on film. And the one before that had even fewer pictures because it was so expensive and cost prohibitive. And before that, they were only black and white. And only the rich could afford to have their photograph taken. Average people didn't get that experience. Today we take more pictures in one day than anyone in previous generation has ever taken in a lifetime, even photographers. You probably have more photos in your phone than most photographers used to take in a career. And I don't know about you, but I can flip to my cloud and I can go back and I can see pictures from 2012. In my cloud that I took. Just scroll through, look at all of them. Some of them, I'm not sure why I took pictures of that. I'm glad now I don't have them printed. I can just delete them when I get there. What is that? I don't remember what that is. Why did I take a picture of that? Danielle has more pictures of sunsets than anyone. She likes sunsets. They're beautiful. You capture that moment in time. We capture more moments, and yet we seem to remember less. The really important things in life, the history of our families, of our country, of our world. And remembering, we can be transported in our minds to that time, that place, that experience, to those people who are important to us. Now, if we're paying attention, we'll find that throughout Scripture there are lots of stones of remembrance. So the children of Israel went through the Jordan. As soon as the priests carrying the altar of the Lord stepped into the water, it was like the waters parted, and they piled, the Scripture says they piled up in front of them. But not only that, but the ground was dry. In an instant. In a moment. And God told Joshua, said, tell 12 of the leaders, one from each tribe, to grab a stone and bring them with you from the Jordan so you remember. So I got a stone for us to look at today. I made this one. It's even a geode. Isn't that cool? They may have had geodes. I don't know what they were. Anyway, so it's a stone of remembrance. Hopefully, when you see the rocks along the road, when you see things, you'll go, oh, that was the preacher's message. Those rocks were there. If we're paying attention, we'll find Bethel was the place where Jacob saw the ladder that was extended from heaven down to earth, and the messengers of God were coming and going on it. And he put a rock, the rock that he slept on that night. He stood it up and he anointed it with oil so he would always remember the place where he saw into heaven, to the Spirit of the Lord. We sing it in one of our hymns about raising our Ebenezer. And if we're not careful, we won't remember that that is the stone of help. And it was Samuel who called the rock, the Ebenezer, the stone of helping. In today's scripture, Joshua had the people take 12 stones from the bed of the Jordan that had not been dry. Think about that now. They had not been dry. They were from the middle of the Jordan. The Jordan River was at flood stage this time of year. It was especially wide, and there was a lot of extra water, but from the middle of the Jordan, those rocks hadn't been dry in centuries. And now they were perfectly dry, and the men went out there and just picked them up, put them on their shoulders, and carried them all the way to the campsite that night. They had been worn smooth over the years. Take 12 stones and make a memory. Is really what he was saying. For you and for your children and your children's children and their children after them, take 12 stones and make a memory. Build them together in a kind of ancient picture that when future generations come to this place, they'll be able to tell the stories of deliverance and provision by God. What memories do you have? What stories have you told your children and your grandchildren about your journey of faith? What stories have you neglected to tell them? Because you've forgotten, or you just never made a memory to be able to do that. Have you relayed your experiences with God to those who come behind you so that they may believe in the God who heals? The God who delivers, the God who rescues, the God who forgives and transforms, the God who parts the waters so you can go through. I think we need more memorial stones. We need to tell the stories more often about how God has rescued us. I've taken the time to craft another stone, not just this one, but one that represents an event in the life of our congregation, in the life of my family. And it's a drawing of Hurricane Katrina, August 2005, to remember and tell the stories of how we survived Hurricane Katrina, of how God used Hurricane Katrina to send us out into the community to minister to people we didn't know, how God brought people from all over the country to this place to be a blessing. And it's the coastline with the hurricane out in the Gulf. Big picture. And so I can tell the story. People go, what does that mean? Let me tell you the story about that. So I thought it would be good today to give some of you a chance to tell your stories. You're gathered in family groups, for the most part, already. We have some stones for you. These, by the way, can be used as coasters for you to draw a picture, put a word in. Don't try and write the whole story on the stone. Make it something that you have to tell the story. But it sparks the memory of the thing that you would have. And think about your life and about those significant events in your life where God was present. And what would you put on the stone that you would then take home with you and you would tell the story over and over to those who come after you about your life? Bring to your attention today. We got those already done. Very soon, in the life of our congregation, our fellowship, we will open the cornerstone of this building. Before we move and relocate, inside the cornerstone is an envelope from 1972 that had things that were important in the life of this congregation at that moment. And so we'll open that and we'll remember and reflect on 1972.
Good year.
And in addition, all of the other 48 years that we have inhabited this space. Think about all that's transpired here in those 48 years that we've been using this building. Scarcely any of us remembers the day that that stone was put into place. There are a couple. Each of us has been profoundly impacted by the events of those days. Or this had been a place of dreams, visions, of hopes, and a sanctuary for generations of believers. And so we want to relive that at some point before the end of the year, probably before the end of the summer. We'll open that vault and we'll pull out that envelope and we'll see what treasures they left for us in that space to retell. How blessed we are to be able to unseal those documents and reflect on their memorial stones. And yet how poignant that more people aren't here to relive or to retell those stories. How God has provided over half a century in this place. So I tell you today, it's important to grab a stone every once in a while and to build a memory But as important as it is to grab a stone and build a memory, it's even more important to tell it to those who come along. Because if you just grab a stone and build a memory, when you're gone, the memory goes with you. But if you tell the story to the next generation and the generation after that, then they can pick up the stones and tell your story, and then they can add their stones and tell their stories about how God has worked in the hearts and the lives of His people through all generations. It was an instruction that God gave the children of Israel, even in the law. Tell these things to your children. Meditate on them. Talk about them when you walk along the way. Talk about them when you're at home. Talk about them when you get up in the morning and when you lie down at night. Tell the stories over and over and over about how God has been at work in your life, in your family, in your world. Father, we're grateful for this opportunity we have to reflect upon the events of our lives and pick just one that tells the story of us, how we got here, how we came to this place, how we came into your presence, how we became a Christian, how we live through a dramatic time, and that you provided for us. Father, thank you again for drawing us together as families to be able to share these stories. And allow us, as we practice them with one another, to share them then with someone who is a stranger, but who needs to be part of the family of God with us. By telling our stories, help us increase your family, your kingdom. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Closing song says that God will be glorified in all areas of the world. Peace.